Hey guys, welcome back to Halidom. Camille again. So last week was a pretty heavy episode. We talked a lot about attitudes, particularly in the US surrounding refugees and immigrants. We looked at what the Bible has to say about this issue and how the culture that produced the Hebrew Bible was influenced by the experience of refugee life. We looked at the data and graphs to get a better sense on how refugees and immigrants affect our society today and tried to address some of the misconceptions that can pop up when discussing this issue. All that to say, it was just a fairly intense episode. So this week, for the sequel, we thought we'd just take it easy and talk about something light and fluffy like racism. Yay! Okay, so like I said, we've looked at what the Bible has to say, we've looked at the stats, we've looked at the polls, but we really wouldn't be doing this issue justice if we just completely ignored the racial component of this. We have to admit that the United States in particular has a terrible track record when it comes to issues of race. It's just an inescapable part of our experience as Americans, as Homo sapiens, really. If we don't acknowledge that, we're really just not doing ourselves any favors. I've noticed that particularly in predominantly white settings, it's really not polite, I guess is the right word, to bring up race as a topic of discussion. From my conversations with Jordan and with other white friends, I think that this has to do with the fact that white people rarely have to deal with their own race. Whiteness is kind of seen as the default race in American culture, and it can just be taken for granted. This just isn't true for Black people and other people of color. Okay, I'm gonna be super real with you guys for just a second. I hope that's okay. So I'm gonna speak about my experience as a Black person. So I've had a lot of discussions both with my family and other friends that are Black. And to be a Black person is to constantly be aware of your skin and constantly be aware of your race and how other people will perceive you. So remember how we talked about othering last week? I'm gonna give you a little bit of an example of what this looks like in real life. So whiteness is considered the default. So that means anything other than whiteness as a race is in some other category. They're different, they're other, they're separate. So that's how stereotypes and things get perpetuated. So for me as a Black person, when I'm going out and I'm dealing with my everyday life, I am constantly aware that I am in the other category. So I'm thinking about, okay, I need to make sure what I do doesn't perpetuate anyone else's preconceived notions about everyone else about my race. I just don't want to give anyone an excuse to treat me poorly or differently because of my race. And I also don't want to give anyone some lame or weird excuse to attribute my behavior and my personality to literally every other Black person they interact with or see. So it's kind of a weird type of feeling because you can't escape it. So I know that this is just my experience, but I can't help but imagine that this might be similar for people of Hispanic and Middle Eastern descent. And if I'm wrong, or you guys do agree and this is kind of your experience too, go ahead and leave that in the comment section below and we can talk about it. And that's just one of the many ways that these kind of racist ideas manifest themselves in our society. And sadly, they start early. Robin Diangelo describes a study in her book where psychology researchers tested 283 white children aged 6 to 7 and 9 to 10 years old. The children were asked to allocate money to white children and Black children, sometimes with a white adult in the room and sometimes with no adult in the room, to see if having an adult present influenced their behavior. The researchers found that the younger group discriminated against Black children in both conditions, while the older group discriminated against the Black children only when no adult was present. This finding is significant because it shows that the older children clearly had racial prejudice and acted on it, but hid it when a white adult was present. Thus, the children showed that they did not become less racially biased with age, but that they learned to hide their racism in front of adults. The researchers found racial hostility in white children as young as 3 years old. However, most white parents and teachers believe that children are colorblind. This false belief keeps us from honestly addressing racism with children and exploring with them how racism has shaped the inequities that they already observe. Definitely a lot to unpack there, but we can really begin to see how racist attitudes can creep in very early, disturbingly early, and can simultaneously fade from our notice as we're socialized to hide it. And I don't think that what's going on here is these kids are just evil little racist gremlins. They're just reproducing the behavior that they see as they absorb lessons about race that our culture teaches them. And you can also begin to see that it's just not as simple a thing to deal with than it's often portrayed. I think that there's just this obsession in our culture with not being racist, as if racism is just a switch that's either on or off. But that's really an oversimplification, even on a personal level, of what's happening. I think a better question to ask rather than, am I racist, might be something like, how am I currently managing my implicit biases at this moment? See, the am I racist question kind of assumes that there's a way to completely avoid racism, that you can just put up a racism barrier that nothing can get in and affect your pristine, racism-free mind. But as we've seen in the kids study that we looked at, in all likelihood, it's already there. It's a lesson you've been unconsciously absorbing since you were literally a baby, and so we have to develop strategies to deal with it. Part of not being a racist is somewhat paradoxically acknowledging the racist views and reactions that our bodies have been trained to have. And only then, once you've been truly honest with yourself, you can actually start to address it. But we know from study after study, these views are out there and they affect people. And refugees have to deal with these negative views as they navigate the process of seeking safety here in the US. Asylum seekers can be perceived as less deserving of our help due to these prejudices. They may have reduced access to public services and legal representation based on their race as they enter the country. The government workers handling their case might be harboring some kind of prejudice that they're not aware of. They may not even be intending to treat somebody differently, but due to the way that we're socialized to not acknowledge race-based prejudice, it slips in the decision-making process. And it doesn't even necessarily have to be the work of a single individual. Oftentimes, the systems and processes themselves can work against refugees because of the institutional discrimination that's built into its structure. This lack of resources and help is compounded due to the fact that refugees, because of the traumatic events they fled and the potentially traumatic experience of actually getting to the US, they experience higher rates of both physical and mental health problems. I think that there are some people, even now, who are thinking that these people are getting what they deserve for breaking the law. But let me remind you that refugees face this prejudice despite the fact that it is completely legal to seek refugee status in the US. No one is breaking any laws. It's not a matter of maintaining law and order. Oftentimes, the law is being followed to the letter, even as prejudice persists. This, I think, is where Christians and other people of faith can make a big difference. This is exactly the kind of situation where a firm commitment to honoring the dignity of others, of people who bear God's image, of exactly the people who the Bible encourages us to empathize with. This is where we show that those ideas actually mean something. This is how we show that God is loving and cares for people. But even at the same time that we acknowledge the good that Christ followers can do and have done, it's also good not to forget our shortcomings. There have been times in the past where certain elements of Christianity have gotten intertwined with elements of white identity, and that's definitely something worth examining. But I'm probably not the best person to explain whiteness to you, so I went and found the whitest person I know to go through some of that history.
Hey, as Halidom's in-house expert on being white, I am all too familiar with the somewhat racially charged origins of white evangelicalism, to understate it just a bit. So for instance, I grew up Southern Baptist, but do you know what it was that caused the Southern Baptists to separate from their Northern brethren? What issue it was that they just couldn't agree on? Well, it was slavery. Remember slavery? People in the South didn't want to go to church and be lectured by some Northern abolitionist about how it's wrong to own people. So they separated and started their own denomination where they could interpret the Bible to support whatever ideas they wanted to believe about people of other races. That was over 100 years ago, and the Southern Baptist Convention doesn't endorse slavery anymore, I hear some of you say. In fact, the SBC released a resolution apologizing for their role in promoting slavery all the way back in 1995? Okay, well, better late than never. But okay, let's look at something more recent. Just a few decades ago, you had a very popular movement, in some ways a defining movement of white evangelicalism, the moral majority. This was a movement founded by Jerry Falwell, a Southern Baptist pastor at Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia. And what you'll often hear is that the moral majority was started to combat the recent Roe v. Wade decision. But in actuality, if you actually look at the contemporaneous accounts, it was started to combat the fallout from the Green v. Kennedy decision in 1970. That decision was removing the tax-exempt status from their Christian schools. The reason? That decision said that schools that were still segregated could not have tax-exempt status. Yep, so the so-called moral majority just wanted to avoid paying taxes while still being allowed to exclude minority students from their schools. It was in the context of this culture war mentality that modern patterns for the political involvement of white evangelicals began to form, and many of those harmful patterns persist to this day. Now, I'm not saying this in order to shame all modern Southern Baptists or other white evangelicals. I'm certainly not saying that all Southern Baptists are horrible people or that they all believe in slavery or segregation, but it is important for us to know our own story so that we don't repeat the moral failures of the past. We can't just sweep this stuff under the rug and pretend that it's not part of the legacy of white evangelicalism. There was certainly a time, and I think that this continues to this day in a lot of places, where white identity politics trumps Christ-likeness. And that's just not a place that I think we want to be. But I think that there's definitely hope here. We can train ourselves to be better, but we have to start from a place of humility and honesty. I know that in some white circles, it can be considered extremely impolite to call somebody out on their racism. But if we really commit to be honest with each other and commit to learning where our blind spots are, we can address them without letting pride get in the way. Then I think we can learn to be more loving, more compassionate toward people from anywhere. I'm reminded of this verse in Galatians. There's neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Okay, back to you, Camille.
So Christians will often tell you that they want to make sure they maintain a biblical view of all sorts of topics. But what happens when we let politics creep in? I think that that's really what's happening here. In his book, The Immoral Majority, Ben Howe, a conservative evangelical author, recounts this episode.
In an interview in 2016 with Mike Gallagher, conservative radio talk show host, Robert Jeffress, a Southern Baptist pastor, described how he reacted to the question of whether he would prefer a president who governed according to the principles Jesus spoke of at the Sermon on the Mount. Heck no, Jeffress said. I would run from that candidate as far as possible because the Sermon on the Mount was not given as a governing principle for this nation. He went on to say that governments are exempt from such biblical principles as forgiveness or the willingness to turn the other cheek. Government is to be a strong man to protect its citizens against evildoers, he claimed. I don't care about that candidate's tone or vocabulary. I want the meanest, toughest son of a you-know-what I can find, and I believe that's biblical.
So much for blessed are the peacemakers. I mean, really, just compare what Jeffress is saying to the whole of the Beatitudes. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. It's amazing to me to see a Christian pastor so flippantly dismiss the teachings of Christ, all for a few political points. You get the sense that he doesn't think that Jesus really has what it takes to be an effective leader, which is a weird position for someone who might also profess something like Jesus's kingship. But peacemakers are exactly what we need more of in this conversation. We need more compassion and mercy and Christ-likeness, and not just short-sighted political hackery. So I think in all of this, what we've seen is that this whole thing can really go both ways. And what's going to determine which path we go down is going to be how honest we're willing to be with ourselves. I mean, let's just ask ourselves, what is it that we are trying to hold on to so vehemently? What are we afraid to share? What is driving our decision making? Who's benefiting from me being scared? And what's really important here? Am I giving myself excuses to ignore the dignity and humanity in other people? Every minute, an estimated 20 people are forcibly displaced due to conflict, persecution, or war. I think that the most Christian thing to ask here should be, how do we love these people? I mean, when we think about who Christ is, one of the things we learn is that loving others isn't free. Sometimes it's hard work, but ultimately it's work worth doing, even if it costs us. After all, for if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? We can't just let ourselves off the hook on this one. We can't allow ourselves to not care. Apathy is how we end up with children being taken from their parents and put in cages while it's called justice. We can do better. We can take the words and teachings of Jesus seriously as we explore what compassion and real empathy can do, how it changes us and the people around us.
Fill us with mercy and loving kindness. We know that Jesus is for everyone. Fill us with mercy and loving kindness. We know that Jesus is for everyone. We know that Jesus is for everyone.
Hey guys, thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, go ahead and give it a thumbs up and hit subscribe so you can be notified when we upload our next video.
Also, feel free to leave a comment below. We'd love to hear stories about your experience with this. Regardless of which side you find yourself on, kind of how you have come to terms with this issue, how you've explored this issue, how you've had experiences with regard to this issue, we'd love to hear about it. Just let us know in the comments and we'd love to engage with you on that.
Yep, so that's it from us today. If you also want to follow us anywhere else, we are also on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. All right. Yeah?
Yeah.
All right, we'll see you guys next time.
Bye.
Bye.